Welcome to Best Picture This, where it is always Oscar season. I'm Mike.
And I'm Brian. In this show, we reevaluate every Best Picture nominee from the 21st century and decide whether to keep it or kick it from its Oscar pedestal.
But in this episode, Brian, if we're going to kick the movie, should we tell it to get lost?
In lost. Translation?
You get it? Because of the lost?
I'm starting to get it, yeah.
It's a really good joke. In 2003, the nominees for Best Picture were Master and Commander of the Far Side of the World, Seabiscuit, Mystic River, The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King, and today's movie, Lost in Translation, directed by Sophia Coppola. Let's listen to the trailer.
For relaxing times, make it Centauri time.
Cut, 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 cut!
With intensity.
Is that everything? I mean, it seemed like he said more than that.
Mr. Bob Hollis!
You're a now, Bob.
You're a movie star.
Yes, I should be doing movies. Yeah.
You know Lat Pack?
Rat?
Rat Pack?
Rat Pack.
A ring-a-ding-ding.
Mr. Harris, Mr. Kazo sent me my stockings. Lift them.
What?
Hey! Lick my stocking!
Lick them? What?
What are you doing?
My husband's a photographer, so he's here working. I wasn't doing anything, so I came along.
What do you do?
I'm not sure yet, actually. What are you doing here?
Getting paid $2 million to endorse a whiskey. The good news is the whiskey works.
Help! Can you keep a secret? I'm trying to organize a prison break. We'd have to first get out of this bar, then the city, and then the country. Are you in or are you out?
I'm in.
How are you? I'm Bob.
Bob. You're probably just having a midlife crisis. Did you buy a Porsche yet?
You know, I was thinking about buying a Porsche.
I just don't know what I'm supposed to be.
You'll figure that out. The more you know who you are and what you want, the less you let things upset you.
You really are having a midlife crisis, huh?
I'm finding that in these movies, the things that bother me sometimes are often in the trailer. Like, they're not buried. They're right out in the front.
Front and center, huh?
What
bothered you from that trailer?
In the movie, there are a lot of jokes about they talk differently than
the
we
Japanese,
talk.
They're sort of mocking the other culture.
I mean, look how low the shower head is. Look how tall he is compared to the other Japanese men in the elevator. And in the trailer alone, they do the L and R joke like two or three different times. I don't know. I don't remember that bothering me at all when I saw it the first time, which was, I think, 10 years ago.
But now you're very mature.
Well,
very sensitive.
Is it because I'm more mature, or is it because the world has changed? Asian hate is a thing now, which I wasn't aware of at all back then, and it's kind of impossible to for that not to be in the front of your mind when you see Asian jokes.
Yeah, this movie was there was a campaign against this movie actually by an Asian American organization trying to get the Academy to vote against it at the Academy Awards. So it definitely rubbed some people the wrong way.
Yeah.
And watching it again this time, I also thought it felt a little bit over the top, and I didn't really think of it as much the first time I watched it.
No. I mean, and even if you take the cultural, I don't know, complexity out of the situation, the jokes just aren't funny. I mean, maybe the first time because it's a fish out of water story, but I don't know, to keep banging that drum over and over again. That was the one thing with this watch that really kind of...
To me, with a lot of sort of more culturally insensitive things, we've seen a lot of it. There's in the 2000 to 2003 range, there's a lot of... We've talked about this already. There's like some kind of homophobic jokes.
Yeah, a lot of
that. And I guess I try to try to, I don't know, try to take the movie on the terms that it's trying to do. Yeah. I don't think this is a racist movie.
No.
I think it's, it goes a little too far with kind of poking fun, but Sophia Coppola also responded to this kind of stuff in some of the interviews and was, but I don't know if her responses were totally sufficient. It's like, you can't really tell if the movie is also sort of poking fun or if it's only Bill Murray's experience while he's there.
Yeah.
It doesn't really feel like the movie separates itself from Bill Murray's kind of, you know, fish out of water jokes.
And that's what I mean. The fish out of water thing you need to a certain extent in this movie. It's more like the laziness of the joke and the repetition of that joke is almost what bothers me more than the cultural insensitivity of it.
However, do you think that Scarlett Johansson's character, Charlotte, when she is going to like the shrines and she's admiring the flowers and things, do you think that that helps to balance it all to see that she seems to be also a fish out of water, but maybe sees some respect and reverence for some of the culture?
Not really. Yeah. Because I think that they're kind of trying to do different things. You know, she's so desperate to find...
they're balancing each other out.
I guess so. But that part of the story, she's trying to find something to connect to. Like, oh, well, maybe this is the thing to give me some sense of meaning or purpose.
Which it still doesn't really do for her that much.
Yeah. Bill Murray has his own sort of story of searching, but the jokes are jokes. They're there just to make us laugh.
Yeah. I was wondering though, Mike, seriously, have you bought a Porsche yet? Or has your own midlife crisis not risen to that level?
I think my midlife crisis is going to look a lot different. I think I'm going to be like, let's go out to eat an extra day of the week.
I had a midlife crisis a couple years ago and I took a painting class. So that was as wild as I usually get.
Yeah, I like my cheap cars. I'm never going to be a Porsche guy, Brian. Never going to happen.
Sophia Coppola's movie had a budget of $4 million.
Love that. And it looks so good for $4 million.
It's incredible. It's beautiful. The box office made $118 million.
Amazing.
I was wondering, though, why couldn't Sophia Coppola raise more than $4 million? Her dad couldn't pull a few strings? Come on.
He's in a different part of his career at this point.
Still. It won the Oscar for Best Original Screenplay, Sophia Coppola. That's prestige, winning that Oscar, original screenplay. It was also nominated for Best Picture. Bill Murray was nominated for Best Actor in a leading role, and Sophia Coppola was nominated for Best Director as well. That was actually Bill Murray's only Oscar nomination of his whole career so far.
Okay.
He's had a long career.
Yeah.
He must not have, I never found how much money he made, but it must not have been that much because the whole movie was $4 million. So I was looking up, like, how much did Bill Murray make in other movies? Because why would he take such a small amount, you know, to do this one? And I found that he made his highest pocket was for The Jungle Book, for Baloo.
Wow.
He must have gotten a cut of the gross somehow because he got $48 million.
Wow.
For
okay.
That. Bill Murray also got some other praise. He won the BAFTA for the Best Actor, and so did Scarlett Johansson for leading actress in this movie, the BAFTA. That's pretty cool. It also won the AFI Movie of the Year. Bill Murray won Best Actor for Golden Globe. So interesting. Coming up in the show, we'll do our Farley Awards. Should we do hot takes this time?
Or you stick know what? With let's keep them golden.
Golden. Yeah. We'll each ask each other one question that is designed to help each other belt out the off-key truth of life into the karaoke microphone of ignorance. We will imagine what might have been and talk trivia, and then we'll do the big reveal. Kick it or keep it, or not keep it or kick it.
It sounds weird to switch.
It really does. Keep
like
it
that.
Or kick it. And I'm really curious how this one's going to turn out with you.
Yeah, I'll say that it was more complicated than I thought.
Have you decided already?
Kind of.
Or are you waiting to be swayed by whatever I say?
I like to think that I come in open to change my mind.
You know, I realize that I don't. I never come in open. Only maybe one time in 40-something episodes have I come in not really knowing if I would keep it or kick it. I think I kind of want to do that maybe more often because I would like to be persuaded.
Yeah.
This is what art criticism in general can do, is help you to see movies in a new light. So maybe I'm going to try to make a little less of a definitive decision on that until after the show sometimes.
Maybe my best moment will sway you and you'll start to swell with emotion.
You never know.
So this is my Farley Award for the most awesome moment of the movie. And it's at the very end. It's when Murray is leaving Tokyo. He sees Scarlett Johansson in the crowd. He jumps out of his car and gives her a hug. Mm-hmm. And this is something that we see in rom-coms, you know, where it's kind of at the end and the character runs down the street because they come to a revelation.
And then they state the theme of the movie.
Yeah. And this, it's kind of a have your cake and eat it too thing, because Sophia Coppola is doing that, but at the same time, she's pointedly not doing that. And rather than it being a very, very big emotional moment, it's really quiet. And he gives her a hug, which is kind of, I don't know, an acknowledgement that their time together was important, but it's keeping it all very innocent. Mm-hmm. And of course, he tells her a secret that we don't hear. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that moment has been parodied a lot since this came out. But all those people who are parodying it are wrong, because this is a beautiful choice. I love it because it keeps it, like, forces us to respect their privacy. We have no other option but to stay out of it. And I just think that makes it so much better. So I said that I've seen this 7 years ago. And honestly, I completely forgot that they kissed in this scene.
Yeah, me too. I was thinking that was it was a sexless kind of a relationship.
Yeah.
The kiss a little bit crosses that line, but
it does. I was surprised.
It's an interesting
when that happened. Yeah. And I think I was surprised because it is so not the point.
Yeah.
You know, of their relationship. The secret that they share, I think, is way more romantic and intimate than that kisses, because it's not like, it's not sexual as much as like a validation that they make each other feel seen, pretty much. But after this goodbye, they both sort of disappear into the crowd. And I just think it's the perfect ending to their story and to this movie.
You know that I've been talking about Birth, the 2004 Nicole Kidman movie.
Yep.
There's kind of a similar ending to that movie. I don't think I'm giving anything away really by doing that, because it's a lot going on, but yeah. But that occurred to me, and I realized that I can't really remember any other movies besides those two that I've seen fairly recently. Maybe there are others. I'm sure there are others. But so my Farley Award, there's a serious moment that I'm going to talk about in my golden take, but I really do love the Suntory Time commercial because of Bill Murray's acting.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. I know that there's kind of taking aside whether it's in Japan or something else. The point is that he is being yelled at in another language, and the whole translation problem.
Yeah.
It seems so, it's so classic. Like, you know, he's shouting at him for 30 seconds and he gets like a 2 second translation of it. It's like, what's going on here? And just the fakeness, there's so many layers to that fakeness in his expression.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he does not want to be in Japan, does not want to be doing a commercial. He knows he's selling out by getting the money. His career is, like, you know, in the tank because of it. And he has no idea what the director wants. So he's like faking enthusiasm, pretending and hoping that someone will buy it. But all that is, he's still acting. I mean, he's still Bill Murray. He's not Bob.
Yeah.
So I just love the multiple layers of all that. Also, funny trivia on this is that Sophia Coppola got the idea for doing that because her own father was also in a Suntory commercial in the 70s, really? Directed by Akira Kurosawa.
What?
Yes.
Oh, that's really cool.
That's awesome.
But speaking of the facades and the faking, I was thinking the same thing during that photo shoot that he was doing, which I considered this for my best moment also, because the scene starts with him facing away from the camera and we see all these clips on the back of his jacket that are kind of keeping it fitted.
I love how he goes, he still has them on in the bar.
And she holds that joke. We don't realize that until he actually leaves the bar. But in that scene, we don't see him. He's on the phone with his agent saying, like, I got to get out of here. Everybody's working on his hair and primping him. And then when he turns around, I think that Coppola changes the camera in that scene. And now all of a sudden he's all put together. We see him from the front. We see that background that, you know, makes it look like a magazine
ad.
And
it's that just gorgeous eyeliner.
Yeah. It just says so much about, like, the part that we show the world and the part that we don't. And it's a good, simple moment. The arcade scene.
Yeah.
I also want to bring up, because there were a few
I thought we were doing one.
I just want to bring it up.
One favorite moment, Mike?
It was another good one where Scarlett Johansson is just kind of wandering around the city. Yeah. She winds up in an arcade. And to me, the scene is like, this is depression, the scene.
Yeah.
Because she is an outside observer in every single way. And her is so engaged and focused and playing these games, and they seem to be having fun.
You seem like someone who is really good at Dance Dance Revolution.
No, but I have played my fair share of Guitar Hero. And she looks at that one guy who's got the cigarette, and he seems very into it.
Those dance games, like, that's the anti-Brian activity. You know, yep. I have no interest or skill in doing that. But I have thought of that scene many times since I've seen this movie. This is probably my third time watching it. And watching one of the other teenagers who's playing, and he's so good at it that
it
was the hand one.
Yeah.
But the fact that he is dancing for fun while he's playing the game, he's like playing the game and putting his own rhythm onto the game, spinning around, crossing his arms while he's doing it. The skill and the familiarity with that, it was alienating to her.
Yeah.
And that was just a really arresting image in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Sophia Coppola throughout changed her mind and went with different, like, you know, to try to capture the natural, you know, rhythm of the city.
Yeah.
And I kind of wondered if that was kind of one of those that she would just kind of like, we got to get this guy in here. Cause I assume he wasn't an actor, but yeah. I don't know.
He's so locked in and she's so out of step in that scene. Yep. And just the fact that so much attention is drawn to the fact that all she can do is watch people live their lives and have fun. Mm-hmm. And I that's how it feels, you know, to be in that position.
She's supposed to be on vacation. Sort of.
Yeah, yeah.
Golden takes. What's your golden take, Mike?
All right, so playing off of an actor's real-life persona is one of the best and fastest ways to build pathos in a character.
Excellent, excellent take.
Oh, it's so good, because think about School of Rock. Mm-hmm. We did that episode recently, and you bring what you already know of Jack Black to that character, which means that Richard Linklater doesn't have to establish who this person is. We know going in. It's great shorthand. So then you think about some other movies we've done here. Punch Drunk Love. That's the big one, right? Because Sandler has always had a level of anger in his comedic performances. Mm-hmm. Happy Gilmore is based off of that. It's an entire movie based off of the fact that this is an anger guy.
Yeah.
But it's funny. Waterboy is too, I guess, in a certain way.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden, we're seeing it dealt with more seriously in a different light. And so we have to take it more seriously, and it hits harder.
With Bill Murray.
Well, I'm talking about in Punch Drunk Love. That's what they do there. Yeah. And then if you think about Jim Carrey and Zach Braff in Eternal Sunshine and in Garden State, they're playing against type, which is jarring for us to see the darker side, but it hits harder. And so in a movie like this, when the setting is almost supposed to be its own character, you know, Tokyo is like a purgatory in a way, it lets Coppola focus on how these characters are feeling right now instead of establishing who they are, because we already come into the movie with, you know, with sort of a sense of familiarity. We feel like we know Bill Murray, right? And it's kind of a lot of that 1999 feeling in these movies where these characters are longing and they're bored and they're yearning for something more.
The 9/11 malaise.
Yes, in Fight Club and The Matrix and Office Space and American Beauty. That's kind of what...
And John Malkovich.
Yeah, and that's what Bill Murray and Scarlett Johansson are playing in here. At one point in the hotel bar, the band plays Simon and Garfunkel's Scarborough Fair, which is not a coincidence that that's a song from The Graduate. It cannot be. There's also an underwater shot in the pool where Bill Murray's swimming, and we see everybody's legs and their bodies are kind of cut off if you want to really go deep there. And then at one point, Scarlett Johansson talks about feeling stuck, which we heard about in the trailer. And I actually brought this clip so we can hear the full thing, because...
Think of how many things are made of plastic in the movie.
I had a lot of plastic in this movie. But this scene starts with a view of Scarlett Johansson and Bill Murray kind of laying in bed. And they're in a reflection in their hotel room window and at night. And outside, you see all the cars and you see the stars, and it looks like they're floating in space.
Let's never come here again, because it would never be as much fun.
Whatever you say, you're the boss.
I'm stuck. Does it get easier?
No. Yes. It gets easier.
Oh, yeah? Look at you.
Thanks. The more you know who you are and what you want, the less you let things upset you.
Yeah.
So moments like this.
That was a line from the trailer. So, you also love some things in the trailers, apparently.
Yeah, I didn't hate the whole trailer, Brian. I like the music, too. Music in this movie is great.
Music is tremendous.
But moments like this.
Oscar-worthy compilation.
Let's give it a Grammy. Moments like this establish the theme of, and it directly addresses the theme, but the meta element of Bill Murray gets us there first. It gets us there faster. And I like this scene a lot, but I think because Bill Murray stars in this movie, we don't need it. You can cut it and we still completely understand.
You say cut that scene?
I'm saying I like this scene a lot. I like that Coppola does address it directly, but the fact that Bill Murray is in this movie, I think the first shot we see of him is he's in a car and he's looking out at the downtown Tokyo, all the neon lights. And it kind of reminded me of Blade Runner in a way. It's like this, it's like this alien version of Times Square. Mm. And he's this very American personality. And so right away we know that he's at a place.
Yeah.
We get it.
It hits the same note a lot. The movie does, I would say. I mean, even like, you know, he's doing the video, he's doing one photo shoot of Suntory Time, and then he does another photo shoot, and it's basically the same kind
he
of.
He does the commercial and he does the photo shoot.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Sorry. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that is a flaw, I think, of the movie. But my golden take, if your gold is spent, be my guest. What is the achievement? I think this is a question I like to ask myself about all the movies that we watch, especially the Oscar candidates. What is the achievement of Lost in Translation? Is it original? What is it bringing that hasn't been done before, if anything? And the more I thought about it, I believe that this, for me, it's one of the most interesting relationships that I've seen in a movie. It's also among the greatest examples of on-screen chemistry that I've seen in a movie, that you believe that these people like each other and that their natural conversations are totally spot on. And even when they're insulting each other, like they did in that, you know, that bedroom scene, you just believe every single little reaction that they have. I think that is very unusual. Most of the time in a movie, there's something that happens that throws me out of a little bit. In this one, none of their interactions did. And I think that's pretty incredible. The small talk is, it seems improvised, and actually a lot of it is. I mean, there's like the screenplay was only like 70 something pages. But that led to the next question, again, thinking what's the achievement? What's the originality of the story? How do you write a love story in 2003 that's going to feel fresh? Boy meets girl, boy gets girl, right? Every movie is about this. And yet this is a very unusual kind of love story. It's an older married man meets a younger married woman and they don't sleep together. You know, they fall in love in a certain way, but it's an unusual kind of love. It's something that has stuck with me ever since I watched it the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that in a way, Sophia Coppola has made this new love story. And that was one of my favorite scenes, is them lying there in bed. They're fully clothed, which at this point in a love story, normally that's when they would be sleeping together. But instead, they're fully clothed, just trying to like fight sleep and have like this more deep talk about life.
Yeah, killing time together.
Basically, yeah. Yeah. But then the camera pulls back and there are these close-ups on pillows and they're rubbing their eyes and taking three seconds to answer because they're almost falling asleep. And then the camera pans out and you get a straight overhead shot of them lying down and you realize that Scarlett Johansson has been in this quasi-fetal position the whole time. And then Bill Murray's character, he puts his hand on her bare foot.
Yeah, the smallest touch.
So small.
Oh, it's so good.
And it's paternal, it's platonic, but yet it's very intimate. It's kind of surprising. It adds to the tension. And yet that's all that happens. It doesn't lead to anything. So it's a fascinating relationship captured on the screen about something very ordinary, about two strangers meeting and finding a connection. But it's an extraordinary example of it, you know, this. And so I think that's the achievement of it. She has succeeded in creating a new, fresh feeling, what I would consider a love story. It basically is a rom-com, but with two very different characters, very different stage of life, and that never actually come together in the way that you would expect. So that makes it, I told you after I watched this, I find myself loving the characters more than the movie,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I thought, as I was deciding, am I going to keep this or kick this movie? I thought through my reaction to Castaway also. Like the acting and the Wilson scene, it's like one of the most memorable scenes of a long time, not just of that year, you know, not just of that movie. So I thought maybe I'm being too hard on it to say that the movie has its flaws. Yes, it's hitting one note a lot. I think that sometimes the scenes are just too long, you know, but that relationship is quite remarkable.
And it's a mood piece.
It is.
So,
yeah.
So that's always something that you have to, that I struggle with sometimes.
What is it trying to accomplish? It's not trying to hit all the plot beats like most movies do.
No.
It's not trying to do that.
But when you can call a story a mood piece, that means that sometimes you have to be in the mood for it.
True.
And if you're a little more anxious than usual on a certain day, which I have those days, and when I watch this, I kind of was like that. And
I don't see that.
Also, I had to stop this movie in the middle to like clean up after my dog twice. So it's, you know, when you're watching a movie at home, you have those dumb little things that kind of like break the illusion. Mm-hmm. And especially when a movie is so about you kind of locking in and just sort of drifting with it, little things like that could break the drift.
I can see that. I can see that. Just like for a comedy, I have to be in really just the right mood for a comedy to work for me. Like mm-hmm. I have to just be willing to go along for the ride. And a lot of times I'm just not really in that space for some reason. I'm too uptight, you know. But
yeah.
But the mood piece, it's a type of movie that, as I was reading about it, I found that there was scholarship about this movie. You know, there's like,
we're creating scholarship right
we
now,
are.
Brian.
I mean, I consider this a scholarly
peer
show.
Peer review it. I'm not going to find any holes.
But I think that it's the type of movie that you can sort of analyze it like you would literature.
Yeah.
More so than a lot of other movies that we have done in the past 40 episodes.
And I guess the genius of it is the fact that I kind of want to argue with you that it is a love story at all. Like yeah, I kind of want to say it's not.
I thought it was a flat out hilarious comedy. That's what one of the descriptions said. Is it a hilarious comedy?
Hilarious comedy.
That's what it wants. That's how it's marketed, because how else are you going to market it? It's starring Bill Murray and he's making all these jokes about being lost in translation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's a big dude in an elevator with small people, right?
Yeah.
So it's a hilarious comedy starring Bill Murray. Come on out to the theater.
But what's funny is it is full of jokes.
Yes.
Like it is trying to make you laugh, but they're not
smiling
funny ha-has.
Jokes. They're smiling jokes.
Exactly. So the whole time you go like, I like Bill Murray. I like that scene. That was an enjoyable joke, but you're not laughing out loud.
It's kind of the opposite of Bruce Almighty, which I also recently watched.
Yes, it is the opposite of Bruce Almighty. But what I mean about arguing with you about the love story thing is the comedy, that's one part of it, but also that you can just look at this as a story about two desperate people who are just clinging on to each other as life rafts because they're familiar faces.
You are a big fan of Before Sunrise, right?
Oh, love
Richard
it.
Linklater.
Yeah.
I remember watching it and being like, I kind of get why people get this or excited about it, but I didn't really I didn't fall in love with the movie like I know some people did and like mm-hmm. you did. It's one of those, I'm suspicious. I like movies that have like 95% critics, but when it's 100, you know, it's not gonna be that good.
Yeah. like The Godfather.
But I'm really curious to watch. I can't wait to see Before Sunrise whenever we get to it. What year is it?
Oh, we've passed it.
Oh, but there's Before Midnight is coming up. Yeah. I'll probably try to watch Before Sunrise before we get to that.
And Sunset before Midnight. Because they're all sort of about a stage in life. I mean, the first movie is a love story as much as it is just about being a very specific age and having a specific encounter that you're probably too cynical to have when you get a little bit older.
But it's also basically about small talk.
Yeah.
It's a relationship that is like unfiltered. You know, we're not trying to make these people get, we're throwing away any expectations of plot points. And it's just, here's a conversation with these people. And I feel like this has sort of that kind of vibe to it. As did in some parts, Garden State. But how do you compare this movie to Before Sunrise, for example?
I mean, I kind of think of the Before trilogy as a whole.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's sort of...
It should have been a six-hour movie, right?
Well, I think they're all shot like 7 years, with 7 years or so in between them. And then in Before Midnight, it's a very, very different look at this couple than it was when they were, you know, 20 years old or whatever. Mm. I don't know. I like the trilogy more than I like this movie, but I might like this movie more than I like the very first Before Sunrise. I don't know. I don't know. But I think that they are both about like-minded people finding each other and what happens when that happens. Mm-hmm. And you can kind of look at this movie in that sense and say, well, it's not romantic. So the kiss didn't have to happen at the end. Or if you are a more, you know, sentimental person, you can say, well no, they're like soulmates and somehow they found each other.
Are they going to see each other again? Is this relationship going to continue? What do you think?
No, I don't think so.
I kind of think not too. The questions.
One last thing about finding a like-minded person.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Anna Faris in this movie.
Yeah.
Who is really, really, really good.
Great work. Both she and Giovanni Ribisi.
Hey, I'm not sure.
I forget what his last name is. I'll have to look it up while we're talking. But yeah, they both played their roles so well.
And I forgot that she was in this, and she's just, she brightens up every scene that she's in in a way that I think Coppola really wanted her to.
Because uncomfortable.
But it's such a contrast between her energy. But what I thought was interesting is throughout the movie, first Scarlett Johansson sort of makes fun of and dismisses this person to her husband. Mm-hmm. And then later on, and her husband argues with her, tries to defend her, like, why do you have to act like you're smarter than everyone? Mm-hmm. And then later on, she's singing karaoke and Bill Murray and Scarlett Johansson together kind of make fun of her. You know, they're like, oh, this one, she's got to be the center of attention, yada, yada. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing. She seems way happier than them.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they're kind of like, this woman is vapid. We see a scene of her talking about like, oh, me and my movie with Keanu Reeves, we both have two dogs. We're so alike. And we're supposed to think this woman's an idiot, right? Mm-hmm. But at the same time, she's unselfconscious. She's having fun at the karaoke, singing badly.
She's in Japan enjoying herself. Yes. Unlike these other people who are there supposedly having a good time.
And I always like when a movie does this, where they put us in a position where we like the protagonists, we're on their side, we see them kind of agreeing that someone else is lesser than them. Mm-hmm. But we as an audience member say, well, why? Why is it? Maybe you guys are the downers because you're just moping around all the time. She's the one having fun.
Sophia Coppola kind of trapped us, but gave us, it's sort of like, it's letting you discover a piece of truth without being, you know, preached.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the juxtaposition of the relationships does. And it's well done.
Okay. Questions.
All right. Questions. My question is this. The script. The script is skeletal. 70-something pages. So should that disqualify Sophia Coppola from the original best original screenplay? If you know that there's a lot of lines that are improvised, why does she get credit for writing it? What do you think that
maybe the editor should get credit for picking? But then again, she is directing the editor to say this is the line that we want,
and maybe she's telling Bill Murray, no, that line doesn't work.
Yeah,
let's keep going. Find me something.
Yeah,
you know, I don't know, but when you think of best original screenplay, you think of that they
sat down at a typewriter and they got the whole thing. I'm going to write down every word.
Let's see.
But the boss always gets credit for everybody else's work. You know, why should it be any different here? Bill Murray's the one picking out these great lines. Scarlett Johansson's just, you know, she's bouncing them back. Mm-hmm. And Sophia Coppola is going to come in and say, those words are mine. Is it fair?
It was
no.
It was Bill Murray's idea to do the... So Sophia Coppola wrote dialogue that was not used, and instead Bill Murray whispered the inaudible dialogue, and she decided it was better to not dub it in so that, you know, so you could hear it.
Mm-hmm.
Also interesting decision it's collaboration. I mean, totally collaboration. It's that, I mean, you can't say who was responsible for that. Coppola decided to leave it. Bill Murray came up with an idea. But I don't know. It's just interesting. I guess I don't know how I would answer the question. You didn't answer it either. You didn't say yes or no.
I mean, I think that if her name is on, if her name is on the script and she's being able to cherry pick her lines, whether she earned it or not, I think it's besides the point. the words are hers.
Yeah.
So yeah, I guess.
You're saying yes.
I guess so. Right. Yeah.
What's your question for me?
Terry Lawson, Detroit Free Press. He said, there's a real magic afoot in Lost in Translation, the sort that is created not at the wave of a wizard's hand, but at the coming together of two wayward souls. And I think that that's true. Mm-hmm. Even though the relationship here is pretty platonic, you know, it's more about like loneliness and connection than it is anything sexual. But there are a lot of long stares into each other's eyes.
Oh, yeah.
There are flirtatious touching of ankles and feet.
Bare feet.
And I get all of that artistically. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like, they're lost not only in Japan, but in life, and they're grounding each other.
In each other's eyes.
We feel that. Mm-hmm. Lawson says that feeling is magic. But at the risk of sounding like a prude, and maybe I'm talking to the right person here, because...
Oh, if there's anyone who's a prude.
It would be you.
I watched this movie edited.
There's so little. I guess there are some things. Anyway, but I understand this artistically, you know, but when I think about this in real life terms, it's way more complicated because, like you said, these people are married.
Yep.
And we get to feel good about their relationship because it's innocent. But would their spouses feel the same way?
It's not emotionally innocent.
It's not. It's an emotional affair.
They're having an emotional affair. I would definitely think that is true, to the point where what would you think that Scarlett Johansson's character, I mean, if it was a physical thing, then she would probably, she should feel obligated to go talk to him about it. What about emotionally? Does she feel obligated to go and say, you know, I met this guy, we had a really great connection.
She's not going
to
do that.
What should she say to
him? She's not going to do it.
Yeah, I don't know what you would say.
I guess this is what I'm trying to get at here, is that I think about relationship morals. You think about morality as like a universal morality in movies. Yeah. I don't really care about that. I think about... relationship morals a lot.
You reduced a lot of my great golden takes from the past into a half a sentence.
Here's the thing. Relationship morals are complicated because a director has the ability to stack the deck in any direction that they want. You know, we're following a main character and we don't want to complicate our view of that character because on some level we need to root for them. Mm-hmm. And like rom-coms, they do this a lot. If we as the audience want this woman to leave her husband for this better guy, then her husband has to be boring mean.
Or he's hot and a jerk.
Yes. Yeah. There's always something to take away that gray area. So I guess the question is Coppola doing that here? Like, did you ever think about the moral ambiguity between their relationship or the guilt that should maybe come with it? And should we be thinking about that?
Well, it made me think I guess I said before just a minute ago that they're having an emotional affair. I guess I'm not really sure that I would be that definitive on that actually.
And they did smoocheroo.
They did. Yeah, that does kind of cross the line somewhat, but
it's an innocent smoocheroo.
It feels like a platonic kiss, sort of. Maybe not.
That's what I mean, though.
Yeah.
It's movie logic. Because if your wife was like, I met this guy, we got along, it was innocent, don't worry, we had kissed, a platonic kiss on the mouth.
A kiss at the end.
You would feel a lot differently than if you cheated. Saw it on a screen.
Yeah.
So, like, I guess I'm always trying to figure out, like, what can I learn from that separation between, like, how we view characters and the grace that we give them mm-hmm. when we're watching a movie, and how different that is than how we would react in real life if we were in the exact same circumstances.
Yeah, that's interesting. That this is what is so great about art and is so, can be so instructive. I mean, it's kind of like this safe place to be analyzing other people. You know, we're not gossiping about people down the street. We're discussing art, you know, but you can still.
When it comes to stacking the deck though, mm-hmm. I think that Sophia Coppola does do that because.
By showing
us hints of their partners. So we see Scarlett Johansson's husband who seems very aloof and disinterested in her and he's always busy. And then when he sees Anna Faris, he lights up. Mm-hmm. He seems very, you know, happy to see her. So we're supposed to think like there's something going on in this relationship. Mm-hmm. We see one scene of him where he's talking about his photo shoot and he's saying like, I thought that they should have been wearing their real clothes. And this other guy wanted them to put on like rock and roll clothes. And he's like, what do you think about that? And she barely says anything like, I guess so. And he goes, yeah, that's what I think. And just keeps steamrolling right past her. And then Bill Murray's wife is kind of seen as a nag who only cares about the carpet. But like, Scarlett Johansson's only there because she had nothing else to do. She's tagging along. She can't expect him to be her entertainment committee. Mm-hmm. And Bill Murray has left his wife to be a single parent. Mm-hmm. Like,
that's basically his career choice. Yeah. Essentially has done that.
But I think that by seeing those scenes where we see their spouse is like a little bit of a nag or emotionally distant, then in our minds, we give the main characters the space to, you know, have an emotional affair without us feeling guilty about it.
I think that it does. I don't think that we're supposed to have no guilt about the emotional affair. I think it's supposed to feel complicated. But I think that a lot of this is about alienation and probably the connection that they made, was stronger because they were more vulnerable because they were
yes,
alienated.
Yes.
This wouldn't have happened in San Francisco. It happens in Japan mm-hmm. because they're fish out of water.
They make each other feel less alone. And that's the point.
They do.
And that's what I mean. I get all that artistically,
yeah.
but it's the reflection of real life where I feel like it mm-hmm. gets a little bit more complicated.
It does. And it's hard to imagine feeling okay with this if that was your wife or you were doing that. Yeah. So lesson learned.
Lesson learned.
Morality.
Yeah.
I think that we can safely judge that they were probably too familiar with each other than they really should have, since they were married, you know, like but I think the question becomes, what can they do to make their marriages what they want them to be?
Mm-hmm.
Bill Murray's trying a few times to say things and then he just easily gives up because she's being, you know, kind of hard on him. And Scarlett Johansson also, her character she makes some overtures to try to do it, but they need some more serious discussion and work in their own marriages. Maybe this relationship helps them to figure out what they're missing. Who knows? Hopefully it would. The tragedy of it is that they probably go home and they may just never really get over this little relationship that they had. And they may always wish that they still had it, even though it's not really their life.
But what if Bill Murray picks out the right color, the right shade of burgundy for the carpet, and his wife would be happy and the problems will be solved, right?
Who knows what it could be? He probably should go ask her, what would make you happy? How should our marriage be?
Yeah.
You know, they need some marriage counseling.
I think so. I think so.
Okay. So what might have been? Bill Murray was considered for many roles. So I'm just going to go through a few of his. Could you imagine Bill Murray as John Keating instead of Robin Williams in Dead Poets Society?
Yeah, I could see that.
I could see that too. It would be different. Mm-hmm. Robin Williams has like such an earnest, genuine, you know, good guy.
Yeah, and he's always kind of bubbling underneath the surface with enthusiasm, which I think you need for that.
Bill Murray turned down Steve Carell's role in Little Miss Sunshine. Could you imagine him?
I could really see him in that.
I could too. He opens up as like the guy who tried to commit suicide, and you know, he would do well. Steve Carell was great in that role too. Could you imagine Bill Murray as Batman, Bruce Wayne?
No.
Now that's because we have turned into the hardcore Tim Burton to Christopher Nolan Batman. But he was considered for a movie when it was going to feel a lot more like the 1960s TV series. So who knows?
So this is pre-Michael Keaton?
Yes.
Okay.
He was considered for Han Solo. Star Wars. I don't see that. But I'm supposed to ask you.
Harrison Ford.
You are even doubting. You're thinking about Bill Murray as Han Solo right now.
The early, I mean, all Star Wars, I guess.
Can you imagine him with a holster on his hip with a blaster on his side?
Kind of, yeah.
Bill Murray?
They all have a lighthearted, you know, quippy nature about him. And yeah, 70s Bill Murray, maybe.
I'm not even going to ask you about Indiana Jones because
less quippy.
Yeah. He had a choice to make.
Don't we
Scrooged
all?
Or big? Scrooged or big? He chose Scrooged. I've never even seen Big all the way through.
Oh, really? So.
But it's iconic Tom Hanks, so it's kind of hard to imagine that. Robert Zemeckis and Steven Spielberg originally wanted him to be Eddie Valiant in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. They couldn't get a hold of him. And he finally heard about it, and he apparently, when he found out that he had been considered and didn't get it, he screamed because he wished that he would have
taken it. It's a great movie. I love
Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I also have not seen Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Oh, you're missing out.
We'll have to do a patron. Maybe you can become a patron to our show.
Yeah, do a bonus episode.
Trivia. Bob and Charlotte don't exchange dialogue until 32 minutes into the film. Another kind of departure from what you would expect. Do you think that it's too long? Are those 32 minutes too long? First 32 minutes.
I think that if you really wanted to say, can you edit this movie down? You could trim a lot of pieces and parts here and there, but then it would have a very, very different feeling. And I think so much of this movie is the mood. And so it's a different movie. It becomes about its plot beats rather than about its mood. And
I like plot beats. I'm a big fan.
I guess so. I think it's fine. So, and another thing about this being, you know, kind of a borderline romantic relationship or platonic, the first time he sees her in the elevator, he's checking her out. And that's purely a sexual thing. He's trying to get her attention.
Even though she's 17. In real life, she's 17. She's actually 20.
Is she 17 in this movie?
In this movie, she's 17.
Wow.
That's incredible, right? Huh. She's 20, young 20s in her character.
Wow. Okay. I didn't realize she was so young. That's crazy.
So for the character of Charlotte, Sophia Coppola drew from her own feelings of early 20s disorientation because, I didn't know this, but she was married to Spike Jones at the time. And he was, you know, making this movie about Cameron Diaz being John Malkovich. And that may have also been the John and Anna Faris, the Giovanni Ribisi Anna Faris relationship may have been a little bit inspired by Spike Jonze's fascination with Cameron Diaz in that movie.
Okay.
Again, real life informing, you know, when you learn that a movie was inspired by something in their real life, what's your reaction to that?
I'm sure every movie is.
Yeah.
And, you know, some
any
way.
Any art, somehow, seems like it is often, but does it feel in some way somewhat more authentic, or do you try to just cut that out and you almost wish you didn't know that?
I don't care one way or another. No. It's trivia to me.
Literally, I mean.
I think when you're watching a movie, you can feel if it's a more personal movie or if it's more like a stylistic exercise or something. This is definitely like a personal, emotional movie, you know, exploring that like wanderlust.
It feels very personal.
It's like that quarter life crisis thing is all over this movie, but then you bring in Bill Murray and then you make it a little more universal because then he's reflecting the same thing in midlife. But
Sophia Coppola offered Scarlett Johansson the role without an audition. She was a little worried that she'd be a little too young, but she has kind of this sort of more husky voice, you know, kind of scratchy for such a, you know, for a teenager. All right, Mike, it's time for you to make your decision. Are you going to keep the movie or kick it from the top five?
Well, like I said about being a little more anxious when I watched this movie, I have to say that my experience with it this time, I was a little more out of it than I was the first. I remembered this movie as like heightened emotions. I remembered being locked in. I can't say that I was locked in this time. But like that scene in the hotel room that I played before where they're reflected on the glass and just the metaphor of them being floating in space, you know, you don't need any of the dialogue to understand what's going on. Like that stuff is top tier filmmaking.
Yeah.
And then you throw in Bill Murray's performance, which I think is great. I'm a little bit surprised that Scarlett Johansson won the BAFTA because I think that she's very, very good in this, but she's not given a whole lot to do.
Yeah, in the early scene, in the first 32 minutes where she's just kind of hanging out in the hotel room in her underwear, you know, wishing that she had something to do.
Yeah.
That conversation on the phone where she feels like she doesn't know what to do and she's crying right there, that part I thought was quite affecting and was strong. But yeah, I agree that it's mostly like, can you pull off having this small talk, trading some kind of smiley jokes with Bill Murray? Seems like you could. I respect Scarlett Johansson a lot. I think she's really good in the movie, but I don't think that there's a huge range, say, you know, she deserved to be. I mean, this is the same year of Charlize Theron in Monster. And she won the BAFTA over Charlize Theron. I need to double check that in
this
my
movie,
notes.
This movie is not about range. It's about subtlety.
Yeah.
And so if you're not locked into that.
Winner of the BAFTA, yes, Scarlett Johansson.
So
over Charlize Theron?
And I have to, the repetition, like you said, of, you know, repeating these themes, the lazy Asian jokes, I have to say I was put off by
it. Hurts the movie a little bit.
I just felt like they were cheap, and a Best Picture winner shouldn't be kind of full of cheap jokes, not just, you know, thrown in there, but kind of chock full. But the cinematography and the performances and just the kind of unique emotion that's behind this thing, it's on my short list, and I keep cheating here.
You do.
But I'm telling you, so far, I'm having a hard time with 2003 so far because there's a lot of them that are. I haven't watched many 2003 movies where I've been like, yes, that is on the list. That's a top five. They're all kind of, they're going to be in the top 10. We'll see where they land.
Yeah. So basically, are you trying to tell me that you're not going to say? I'm pounding on the table right now.
You're entrenched.
Yes.
I am going to keep it.
Okay.
Because it does deserve consideration for my top five. And I think that is the rubric.
It's not the rubric, Mike. It's top five.
It can't be top five definitively if we haven't watched the other movies. So the rubric is it seriously a contender for the five? And this one is. Will it end up there? I'm not sure.
Well,
but for right now, I'm holding it there.
I have a couple of times changed my mind, so I guess I can't be too hardcore on you. Although I do live my life hardcore.
Yeah. Well, you're not hardcore unless you live hardcore. But I do love movies that are very, very small like this, but have big emotion behind them.
I thought when I was looking at the list that this was a 100% lock and a likely number one. When I watched it again this year, I realized that it was more borderline for the top five.
Yeah.
I'm going to also say keep. It is the most memorable on-screen relationship of the year, Although, again, Monster is... When I first watched Monster, I thought, it's so dark and disturbing. I don't really want to put it on my top five. But I keep thinking about it. I keep thinking about it.
What kind of rationalization is that?
Because it's my favorite movies.
Yeah.
You're the one. So I'm going to say keep, but I was a little bit more bothered by some of the pacing of it than I was the last couple times I saw it.
Yeah.
And, I'll be excited to do the finale and have to kind of put our feet to the fire, so to speak.
A lot of greatness in it, but I'm a little hesitant to say that it's a purely great film.
It's not an obvious lock like Master and Commander for the top five.
That's another one.
In the next episode that we do, we're going to talk about Mystic River.
Yes.
Directed by Clint Eastwood, starring Sean Penn, who won Best Actor, Tim Robbins, who won Best Supporting Actor, and Kevin Bacon, who's been in so many movies. It's about abuse, murder, tragedy. Does that sound like a fair summary?
Yeah, I think that's fair.
This is, the tagline is, we bury our sins, we wash them clean.
This is another one I haven't seen in like 10 years. I loved it when I saw it. I'm looking forward to watching it again.
Extremely disturbing. It's one that my wife would refuse to ever watch again.
Really?
I'm excited to see it again. I watched the beginning of it and then, I got distracted. That's how I watch all my movies.
Deplorable. So we want to hear from you. For this one, I'm going to ask, is this Sean Penn's greatest performance? Because he's...
Mystic River.
Yeah, he's different in this than he is in a lot of his kind of... his bigger Oscar-y performances. But this one really sticks in my mind a lot. So let us know and we'll read your answers on the show. You can find us at bestpicturethis.com, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, or by telling your smart speaker to play Best Picture This. We're also on Facebook and Twitter at Best Picture This. And for 15 years of golden takes, head over to Letterboxd where you'll find me, Mike Cavalieri.
Do you have a favorite movie from the past that doesn't get the attention it deserves? If you become a patron of this show by visiting patreon.com/bestpicturethis, you can help choose a movie for one of our bonus episodes. We've done The Fly, Garden State, Bridge on the River Kwai, Drowning Mona, chosen by Chris, Matt, Joey, Spencer, and coming up, Pleasantville, chosen by Maddie. So join the club, become a patron.
Yeah, Drowning Mona should be dropping next week. Thanks to WNZF and Mark Gilliland for producing, and please remember to rate, review, and subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts. That really helps us reach new listeners.
Until next time, remember, for relaxing time, make it Best Picture This time.